Welcome back to Daybreak. My name is Sam Gitoko.
And my name is Nzi Kibiku.
Just to reintroduce the panel, Senator Agnes Zani, Senator Beatrice Alachi, Woman Representative for Murang'a, Sabina Chege, Woman Representative for Nairobi, Esther Pasaris. And we were talking about the breaking news this morning that Governor of Samburu, Moses Lenoklal, has been arrested. He's currently at the EACC. Just to give you a perspective, is that the Governor and the Deputy Governor of that county are wanted by the DPP alongside six chief officers in that government. Three former chief officers and the head of supply management, that government, and also a businessman by the same husband, Ndathi,
they
in
are
regards
being
to 84 million shillings that is right. said to have been transferred to the account of the governor.
They're being charged and prosecuted on three accounts: one, conspiracy to commit an economic crime; two, abuse of office; and number three, conflict of interest.
All right, so let's get back to the discussion that we had, of course, in light of what's happening with this arrest. So, stalled projects, action being taken on public officials based on projects that they may have initiated or they may have used money, then state of the nation. What should we expect to see, say, differently if you are to compare previous years and state of the nation addresses that we've had?
Do you know, I feel sorry for the president, and I kind of understand that this country is so messed up. We let it, this is not something that started in his term. This started from independence. Mm-hmm. We've always been going step by step into corruption, making money, creating a politics of money. You know, that's why politics in Kenya is all about money. So you find anybody who wants to aspire to be a president needs to amass a lot of wealth, because politics in Kenya is very expensive, all right? And I think we have to find a way to change how we do politics. And I blame the citizens of this country. I mean, many a times when I ran for a seat, it was always about money, mm-hmm. money. And the youth, they're unemployed. And I always used to say, this 500 shillings that you're going to get right now, is you're selling 5 years of leadership for 500 shillings. You know, so I feel that the politics of money is what has messed up this country. And the youth who are unemployed really need to reflect on the leaders that they elect. All right. And I think the integrity test is going to be a very hard one to fight against. When we're looking at stalled projects, for me, it's not just stalled projects. It's also shoddy projects, mm-hmm. or projects that are not well thought through. Who takes responsibility? Right now, we have the Huduma number, which I think is a good idea. And that's where we should have started from the very beginning, as opposed to having a new generation ID, then a new generation driving license, and now the Huduma number. All this is money being lost, money that could be used in water, sanitation, housing. The president's agenda four, the four agendas, mm-hmm. are really, really good. We've got food security, but then you've got 150 billion sunk into Galana. Mm-hmm. What went wrong? Who's taking responsibility? Who's going to be fired because of the Galana project? Okay, I mean, you have other countries in the world where one person dies because a bridge collapses, and the whole minister
resigns.
Right. And here in Kenya, you lose 100 billion. Right? How many people have died from starvation and nobody's happening? Nothing is happening. We need a ministry. You know, I hope the president will listen to me. We need a ministry of stalled projects. All right, so that we can actually look at projects in totality, mm-hmm. because we have so many stalled projects. Even with CDF, we've got mm-hmm. stalled projects everywhere. We need to actually have a ministry that's given money to just go and deal with stalled projects.
But is creating a new ministry a solution?
No, because you see, the thing is, every ministry is looking for new projects, and I think we should freeze new projects, completely freeze new projects, mm-hmm. completely. We just need to deal with all the stalled projects. We need to deal with all the shoddy projects. We need to deal with corruption. This country cannot afford to continue saying we're doing this, we're doing that, we're doing the other. Can we deal with food security? Mm-hmm. We don't have enough food. How do we put the money into the farmers so that the farmers can start seeing it viable to actually plant and go into farming? What's happening is our farmland is becoming concrete jungles. You know, if you look at even Runda, all these areas used to be coffee. Fine, we needed the housing. But mm-hmm. what is the alternative land that we're okay. developing? And then also we have to look at health, universal health care. For me, universal health care is not sustainable if we have one premium for everyone. We need to have premiums for the rich, premium for the poor. Now the problem with that is when you start telling the rich companies that the rich that you need to pay double your premium in NHIF so that we could give universal healthcare, you know what they're saying? Show us where the money is being spent. NHIF is riddled with corruption. Why should we put more money? And that's why it was difficult to allow anyone to agree for taxation for housing. So if the president
allow me to cut it short because we'll get to that discussion set over the Big Four agenda later on, but first, before we do that, you're talking about a ministry of stalled projects, but obviously we have a committee that is supposed to be looking at that and looking at the status that is chaired by the Cabinet Secretary for Interior, Dr. Fred Matiang'i. But even as you talk about this, when you look at this project, most of them have been awarded to Kenyan contractors. When you look at contracts awarded to foreign investors or business persons or business entities, for instance, look at the Standard Gauge Railway. It's very expensive, but it's not stalled, it's working. What do we do to our local contractors that despite the size of the contract, you're able to pursue it to completion?
I think it's always about supervision and sanctions. Look at China, look at how it has developed. Look at Singapore and look at how they've developed. You just put sanctions and clearly follow those sanctions through. But sometimes I think also for Kenya, we want to begin to put pressure and take this, I think, directly to the Wananchi's desk. I think we need to present this issue of stalled projects in a different way. We need to have our social audits and our economic audits telling us this stalled project would have created the 60,000 jobs that we need. These stalled projects would have given us the medicine that we need. Because I think now we're thinking about it in terms of money. Mm-hmm. It's gone into somebody's pocket, it has disappeared. Mm-hmm. We'd also want to find a way to get back that money and put it back into the projects. But I think also when we don't correlate, so we're looking at money that has disappeared and be used for what it is meant to be used for, but we're not quantifying it in terms that begin to help people to relate and begin to say, look here, no matter what the situation is, when the project starts, and this is why I think the spirit of the Constitution, especially with public participation, it's only that now in terms of implementation, people haven't really followed it through the way it's meant to do. It's meant to be the people themselves sitting there and saying, we want this to happen from A to Z. Mm-hmm. So for as long as you have local contractors who know they can get away with it, then they will get away with it. Mm-hmm. Because I think that's usually the nature of things. But if you have sanctions, and I think a culture, so if you're talking about these foreign investors, if you're looking at the work ethic, for example, compare work ethic in Kenya and maybe another country, probably in the West, mm-hmm. you're finding somebody will report maybe at 8 to 5 because they have to report. So the culture, the way you have integrated it, you know, you have to work, you will deliver. Mm-hmm. It's the same principle they will put into place when they're in Kenya, they will deliver the project. Maybe they will go with that work others. Maybe they will also want to protect their name. But okay. I think sometimes for local investors, it's that you're getting the money, you become amorphous, you're able to disappear. We're not putting names. You know, it's good, like this morning, we are reading the 14 names. But tell me after we finished with them this morning, who is remembering them? You know, do you remember the names? You just read the 14.
Yeah, exactly. So, Senator Elachi, so what do we do to these local contractors? Because the complaint yesterday, we had a panel of four gentlemen, and they were saying that a contract like the SGR, we procure a Chinese firm to do it. Then we're also procuring the materials being used from China. So how do we empower our contractors, improve the capacity so that this money keeps circulating in the economy, but we have results for that?
Well, and now the results is, again, the local company does this. You see, that is where the biggest challenge has been. And not for, I mean, for many years, mm-hmm. I think, us Kenyans, our own culture, in terms of how we look at our own public resources, people say, hiyo ni pesa ya serikali, but they forget it is your taxpayers' money. And that is why we've had that culture of where a local contractor will just, because after all, you've gone, you've given your 10%. You've been left with some little money that cannot even do the contract. Mm-hmm. But you're trying to patch around and ensure you finish. It won't. But those who did the evaluation, everyone has pocketed what they were supposed to pocket. Mm-hmm. And I think we have talked about it for so long. Then the president came and told us we will do audit. I don't know why they decided now we can't do that audit. Mm-hmm. Because it was as simple, it was very easy for us to go through an audit, mm-hmm. which would have helped Kenya. Forget about the top, because these people have been in politics since we were in high school, in campus, they were there. We start from below. Because I always say, from below here is where the problem is. And I will tell you, from below here, it is so unfortunate how we do things as us Kenyans ourselves. The attitude, you walk into an office, you think this is an office where, I mean, let's say, for example, during Kidero's time, we were senators. Mm-hmm. The officers used to say, we want to compete and know who are the below 40 billionaires in Nairobi. And they didn't shy off. And they became billionaires. But what have we done with them? That's why we are saying, me, if you ask me this thing of taking them to this coach, no. The best you can do to Kenyans so that we start fearing mm-hmm. is the moment we will agree. We freeze those accounts, remove the money. Just the way Mheshimiwa said, take the money that we know. There's no way in 3 years you can come and tell us here. Let's say, wait, Sammy. Uh-huh. There's no way in 3 years you can come and tell me, oh, you know what, Sammy? I own 6 apartments. I have 50 million stashed somewhere. And I can see your salary, and I can see, and you're a public officer. And mm-hmm. you're not telling me, before I came into this, mm-hmm. I was doing business here. So this business has enabled me to have this.
And that leads me to my next question.
That's the most unfortunate thing in this country.
Public officers, do you think that then we need to relook this issue of tenders? Should tenders be given to civil servants, people within the public office? Just look at this breaking news that we have on our screens right now with the Samburu.
These are public servants.
These are public servants. So when it comes to tender and procurement and so forth, should the fact that if you're a civil servant, if you're a public officer, that tender should not be given to you? Do we need to have that as...
We can look at many ways, because one is, why can't we digitize, first of all, this tender process? That even you can open and know why Senator Zani or me or Sabina, I'm about to win. What have I done? What specs have I put in that you have tried to put in and it did not work? Mm-hmm. That's why I'm being given. Because all these people who are now not performing, remember, in the tendering process, they were the lowest bidders. That right. thing called lowest bidder is the one that is going to kill our country also. Mm-hmm. Because we go for the lowest, but in the end, when you look at the project, it becomes even beyond what the highest bidder had put in mm-hmm. to finish the project.
So, Honorable Chege, what happened to lifestyle audit? I mean, Beatrice Elachi as well put it, you come into office 3 years, all of a sudden you have 50 million somewhere.
Oh, I tell you, you are
blocks,
flashing everything.
You're flashing your Forbes 40 under 40.
We have worked even us for 3 years. Why are we not right. having this thing? what is this magic?
What happened to lifestyle audit? We sang about it. The president sang about it. Looking into lifestyle audit, what happened to that?
I think what we have been doing as a nation, we just talk and then, you know, we threaten people for the sake of it and then we back off, mm-hmm. which I don't understand why. What Honorable Elachi has talked about is about transparency in tenders. And I don't think even saying civil servants should not apply. If you qualify and you have no conflict of interest, you know, if you're not taking it on your own advantage because mm-hmm. of your position, then any Kenya can transact. Mm-hmm. And I think whether they are families or what, people are in business and people had their lives before becoming either public servants or even mm-hmm. before becoming members of parliament or other position, even the CECs, I believe they had their other lives. Mm-hmm. So if somebody was a lawyer and they become a member of parliament, they might still continue, but don't take your position to take advantage of people. Mm-hmm. What I think is ailing our nation, one, once we talk about this lifestyle audit, who do we send to audit? And then these people have the money. So what do? They just use their money to bribe. And so you find delayed court cases. Now these people from Samburu County are going to be taken to court. So what? Mm. What's next? So you know it's breaking news, but really? So what will happen next? We should have, and I said, we should have special courts mm-hmm. where if it's corruption cases, they should not go beyond 6 months. Finalize with it. I don't even believe about jailing people and giving them, you can jail. But first and foremost, let all Kenyans know, if I steal 10 million, I will have to give back 15 million.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. And it has to come from what I have in all my accounts, whether my properties will be sold, so that I know if I want to engage in corruption, if I am caught, you know things are going to be bad. But number two, we introduced this thing of permanent pensionable, and I don't know what mm-hmm. we're going to do to this nation, because when the civil servants are permanent, they're in those permanent positions. Mm-hmm. One majority of them don't even report to work. When they report to work, their business now is procurement, looking at the people who are doing the tenders. There's no transparency in our tenders. As Elachi again said, let's have a very transparent, if we apply, there's the shortlisting, whether it's the lowest bidder or whatever it is, let us have it in a portal where it is very open.
But do you think the courts can do what you've said, talking about perhaps looking at the bail money? If you steal 10 million, Your bail money is not 200,000.
Of course, that's how it should be.
Do you think the courts will now relook at that issue, especially given where we are as a country when it comes to corruption?
They should. And I'm thinking the issue of fighting corruption is not just about the presidency. That's why I've said if a ministry is mentioned, mm-hmm. we normally focus on the CS. Mm. But remember, the CS is not even a signatory. Mm-hmm. Yes, we're supposed to be responsible and in charge. Mm-hmm. But majority of even these CS, they don't even know the tenders that are happening in their mm-hmm. ministries. Mm-hmm. Sometimes you also see them on the papers, or they even miss them if they didn't look at the papers. Mm-hmm. So we need to look at the person who is doing the real work. Let all workers be on contract. Let everybody, based on your performance, if it's 3 years, even us as members of parliament,
yeah.
we have every 5 years you have mm-hmm. to be re-elected. Mm-hmm. So you have to be very careful on how mm-hmm. you work, because if you mm-hmm. do not work well, you mm-hmm. know you'll not have your seat back. Mm-hmm. So I think we need to start looking at these things. And then how do we do our tenders? SGR, and you have talked about local contractors. Mm-hmm. Local contractors, sometimes they are actually even misused by the people who are in the government. If it's SGR, the Chinese, you pay them on time, you'll even give them tax exemptions, they have all these, you know, goodies that come along being an international contractor. But a local contractor, the first and foremost, by the time you're going there, if it's road, the engineer tells you my 10%. Mm-hmm. Then by the time you go, there's another committee, they ask you for something else. By the time you're even getting the contract, then there's this thing mm-hmm. that comes in, you have, I don't know, the 10% you're paid, you have to buy, I don't know how many cars. I think this is something we need to start asking ourselves, mm-hmm. why do we have, when the roads are being constructed, that there's an element, I call item number one, that they buy vehicles for the engineers. Why can't the ministry buy vehicles for the engineers? And if it's a super highway and there are four or five contractors, when they buy five vehicles, how many vehicles can one engineer drive?
Once upon
a time. So where is our money going? And I think we need to ask ourselves that question.
In January this year, I spoke to the cabinet secretary in charge of trade and industry, and he was saying that the problem with the local contractors, for instance, the engineers that we have, is that once they have graduated, they have been licensed to work, they want to live a certain lifestyle. But in China, the Chinese contractors, the engineers are technical people, that theirs is to work. But you raise very interesting points on the state of corruption. You're saying that we should have a requirement that a case has to be completed within 6 months. That might require legislation. I'm not certain about that. Is that the case?
I think we can. It requires legislation, but we also need the goodwill. I think from the court, from the judiciary, when we talked about the elections, petitions, that somebody would go and petition and then you stay for 5 years and another election has come in and you're still in court. Mm-hmm. We managed. Mm-hmm. If we managed to work on the elections petition, I think that right now there's no one who is in court now. Mm-hmm. Or unless somebody has appealed, mm-hmm. I think we can also make it on corruption.
Okay.
And I think fighting corruption is going to be a concerted effort. Everybody must come in, mm-hmm. and everybody must do their bit.
Okay, so that conversation has been going on for a very long time, including the president says that it's not just him, it's everyone to fight this corruption. State of the Nation on Thursday. I mean, what has changed? What gains have we made despite the noise that we hear that are almost now splitting the Jubilee Party, with some people saying that the corruption is targeting a certain community or a certain political alignment? How do we reconcile all this in the presidential address on Thursday?
You know, I would like to see the president talk about poverty and how people are poor. And what we need now, we need an awakening. We need a consciousness. We need to avoid a revolution. We need to understand that people are so poor. They cannot afford. Every single day you see the poor are getting together, trying to raise money to pay for hospital bills, to buy food, to sustain families, to educate. We need to talk family planning. Mm-hmm. I really hope that the president will be bold enough to say, we need to talk family planning. We don't have enough resources, right, to sustain the population that we have. We have to talk family planning as a country, because we've got a bloated youth that is unemployed. We need to actually look at poverty. In fact, maybe even have another ministry, a ministry just dealing with poverty, all right? Because we're signatories to the SDGs, but we still haven't looked at poverty in totality. So poverty and stalled projects, freezing on any more projects. And right now, any project that you do in this country. If you're going to spend any money, mm-hmm. spend it in an area where you're going to empower the poor, not the rich.
So the Ministry of Poverty, what would they be doing?
The Ministry of Poverty will basically be looking at slum upgrading seriously, because you see, poverty is a vicious circle. To break out of that cycle is very, very difficult. All right. Like yesterday, I had a meeting with the governor, and I said to the governor, as Gov, we're giving these egg trolleys to people so that they can do business of egg trolleys. And then the county council is expecting them to pay 50 shillings. And it's not even a receipt, and it's not even official. It's a guy comes with a funny paper. So that's corruption money. He wants 50 bob. If you don't give him 50 bob, he arrests your egg trolley, he breaks it. So here is the government, through affirmative action, buying egg trolleys for people to do business, all right, to help them have a little. So I'm saying, stop taxing the very poor. We should have had enough markets for them. So long as they're not in a market stall, leave them alone. Let them do their business without harassment. Let us uplift the poor. Let us start thinking about how we're going to get that poor person out. Let us go from homes. We saw that many children did not report to school. Mm-hmm. Let us go door to door. Let us try and build low-cost housing so that we can actually remove rape and incest in the families. Mm-hmm. We can remove alcoholism. We need drug rehabilitation centers. We need to find out who's bringing in the drugs. Do we need to legalize drugs like Portugal did, so we kill the drug barons? Because that's what Portugal did.
But don't you think if every ministry did its job, they wouldn't even be having this conversation of poverty?
Can I tell you, when I look at the county government, which is the devolved government, mm-hmm. all right? When I look at the county government, you've got 10 ministries. One minister, the CEC, has got about 5 portfolios under her. There is no possible way without really good structures. We have not yet got enough good structures where you can say that this is the person in charge of sports, this is the person in charge of culture, this is the person in charge of medicine. You know, look at right now, you've got the main hospitals, level 3, level 4. You need somebody in charge. Do we have medicines? We're collapsing with talk and media. And to be quite honest, I think we've reached a point where we're exhausting the public, okay. And the public just wants to know, how am I going to get my food? How am I going to live in a good house? How am I going to feel safe? How am I going to educate my daughter? And I honestly believe I need the president to talk about how we're going to actually stop borrowing right
okay.
now. We need
okay.
to stop
okay.
borrowing.
Wish must pass, as we focus, I asked the question on the progress that we have made in the war against corruption and the political angle it has taken. So still 2 years down the line into, 2 years into his second term, we're still talking about it. So what's changing?
So I think what we've failed to do is to make sure institutions work. And you find in very solid countries, people don't even know what is happening politically.
Exactly.
You know, from whatever class, you know, you'll meet an aristocrat, for example, and you ask them, so what's happening politically? And they might not have an idea mm-hmm. at all. But the social structures are working, the health structures are working, the economic structures are working. And this is a model that everybody knows about. I think when Obama was here, he also talked about it. Mm-hmm. And I'm hoping even as we wait for the State of Address, State of the Nation mm-hmm. speech on Thursday, mm-hmm. that maybe we should focus more on the deliverables and the actuals, how to do it, not what to be done. I think what is to be done, I think, is clear for everybody now. Mm-hmm. Maybe what we need to talk about more is how do we begin to put structures into place that will work regardless of who is there. That even if we have elements of corruption, we have methods of cross-checking and of auditing and of making sure that corruption doesn't happen. You know, maybe put layers mm-hmm. of people in responsibility so that, you know, things have to be checked. It's not rocket science at all. It's been done. So it's a question of, for example, each of the ministries coming up with a follow-through plan. Mm-hmm. This is the deliverable. How are we going to do it? What are we going to do? When is it to happen? And if it doesn't happen, what are the consequences? And I think now you can see in certain ministries, Kenyans are having faith in some of the ministers there. They feel, oh, with this person, this is possible. With this person, this is possible. So I think once we have also the sort of right thrust into the action in terms of what is required and what happens, we should be able to get to some place. And I also have seen where, for example, people have raised questions, then people are saying, no, this question should not be raised. Why are you asking these questions? Mm-hmm. Kenyans are meant to raise those questions. Those questions are meant to help you even identify the gaps. That's if you look at the system, the parliamentary system we have, it's a multi-layered one mm-hmm. that allows for oversight at all stages, either at the counties and also at the national. And within the ministerial scenario, that should also be. So I hope that the focus can be not so much of this is This is a scenario. We've right. seen this for a long time. What we need is a follow through. This is what we want to achieve under the circumstances we are in, and we know them. This is how we're going to work on contractors who are not doing what they're expected to do. This is how we're going to work on people who are, because we have to attain this particular end goal.
So, Mheshimiwa Elachi, is there a possibility? Timelines very well defined with the mechanisms to measure performance?
Yes, it's possible. You know, it's just, it depends on now how each run their ministry. Because mm-hmm. I've always said also, mm-hmm. sometimes you go into an institution where people have stayed for very long, and they are very comfortable. I mean, let's look at the Ministry of Lands. Today, and I'm hoping P.S. Muraguri and his team, mm-hmm. you need to just do a change of your registrar all over the country. Some have been there for many years until they are so comfortable. Somebody just
does, I think it has happened in some of the areas.
And
like
he needs to do the registrar mm-hmm. of all, uh-huh. so that you start thinking, so that somebody new come in and don't change and bring a friend, this, you know, because that is another thing. As Sabina said, I think one of the things that President has to now come up in civil servants, that there's a job group when you reach, you just have to be on contract. Just like abroad. These things of pensionable where people come in and even tell the President, tumeona wengi wamekuja na wametuacha hapa. You know, that's how they speak. And that's a very unfortunate culture we have. That's why somebody will come and say, after all, I'm taking leave for 5 months. I have never taken my leave. Just because now a new boss has come in and is trying to rearrange things, so mm-hmm. you feel uncomfortable. Mm-hmm. So you go for a leave of 5 months. We need to come up very seriously with mm-hmm. a human resource program that says, these are people, you'll go on contract, you can work in government for 10, 15 years, but you'll go through a contract that right. every 5 years, mm-hmm. or a certain, the years they will agree, you renew your contract. Mm-hmm. That is one. Now, today we have the team of Samburu. I believe when they were going into this work, mm-hmm. we had forms that were declaring, I am coming in and I'm worth 10 million, 5 million. Why are you taking even me in court? You just need to take my form and then go back to my account and look at me from the time I declared this.
Yes.
In my companies, in my everything, in my wife's company, in everything. By the time you finish, you don't need to take me to court.
Wasn't that the job of a lifestyle audit? That was the whole purpose of a lifestyle audit.
You just tell them, look, your declaration form was this. Mm-hmm. Today you are worth this. Now just explain to us this, all so right. that when you are even going to court, the judge mm-hmm. has no time to talk much. Mm-hmm. He will just ask you, did you declare? Yes. Was this? Yes. Then return public resources.
Okay. Mm-hmm. So
prove it.
I wish it was that simple.
It is as simple as that if you want to do it. Because right. then if you want what to is do the it. Purpose is the key, of right? declaring this form? Uh-huh. What is the purpose of asking me all those mm-hmm. questions mm-hmm. when okay. I'm declaring? Okay. And yet now when you are putting me into a court, you are not telling the coach when I declared. Maybe I declared, that is what I have.
All right.
Why are you taking me to court also?